The sixth race of the 2001 NASCAR Winston Cup Series season continues on as we're here at the Texas World Speedway in College Station, Texas. This is the Mountain Dew 500. I'm Joe Rokoski, alongside me, four-time Texas World winner, including back-to-back in 1995 and 1996, Trey Bardo. Trey, this is one unique racetrack, one of the more unique ones we come to. It's like as if Michigan and Daytona had a child, and since we saw a two-mile California race and a two-and-a-half-mile high-bank Daytona race, which one do you think will be more important to focus on how this race will play out, the Daytona race or the California race?
Jeez, you really got to put me on the spot. Like, I would have to say Daytona, because, I mean, it's more of a, you got to make sure you're at the right place at the right type of race, you know? But, I mean, like you said, it's kind of a mixture of both, so I don't know what the bigger lesson you want to be to take here is.
Yeah, I would maybe agree with you in that the higher banking, you know, 22 degrees of banking in the corners kind of lends more Daytona-style racing. Drafting coming into play very big here. And we saw last season in this race how unpredictable it was. Roger Ray for Andy Pietschner Racing led the most laps and led the white flag. But at the checkered flag, Keegan Thompson in the 5 stole it on the last lap, leading only 2 laps to go to victory lane. Keegan starts inside the top 20 here today. He's looking for his first win of the season. But inside the top 5, there are some great names, including Benny Lynn for Andy Pietschner Racing, who starts on pole the number 33. That team, remember, almost won here last season with Roger Ray. We know they have fast cars. They start on pole. Jordan Stout starts in second. Not too big of a surprise there, but then third, fourth, and fifth, big surprises. Tim Gary for MB2 Motorsports inside the top 12 in points starts in third. Ronald Kennington for Jasper Motorsports starts in fourth here today. And Ryan Wilson, who was not locked into the race, he was outside the top 35 in points. He got fifth on speed. So Trey, this top 5, very unique. 5 different teams inside the top 5. In fact, 6 different teams inside the top 6.
Yeah, I mean, you want to talk about it being like Daytona or Talladega. I mean, that shows you right there, these lower class teams, I mean, you can consider them underdogs or qualify really well, so I'm really excited to see what they can do during the race.
And we'll have to see, you know, obviously you mentioned the underdogs, but the bigger teams still looking to get it done. Have Hendrick Motorsports and Richard Childress Racing found some pace in their cars. Two of the Hendrick cars sit inside the top 10 with Sierra in 6th, Zidell in 7th, and then two of the RCR cars start inside the top 15 with Conrad Evans starting in the 8th position, and then back in 13th, Sebastian Kukulon, who's very happy the top 35 in points for this season come into play because he's now locked into the shows as long as he stays inside the top 35 in points. Kukulon starts inside the top 15. Our other driver, Justin Atkins, starting a little bit further back with the new paint scheme, but we'll see if he can make his way to the front. Obviously, it being super speedway, almost type racing, we'll see if he can get it done in that number 29. Two cars did fail post-qualifying inspection. Noah Clifton was set to start inside the top 20. He'll be starting back in 41st, and Caden Lynn, who is fastest in practice, Trey, will start back in 42nd. He didn't have the best of qualifying runs either, so only falls a few positions back, but very big news there. The driver who was fastest in practice starting at the back, and then the 3 cars who missed it, Trey, some big names. Nathan Baird and Brandon Beal have missed races already this season. They've missed again. But the biggest one of the 3 that missed, Trey, for Bill Davis Racing, Jay Randall, winner at Martinsville last season. He's out of this race. It's just been a dismal start to the season for Rando.
Yeah, it's definitely not what he wants to see here. But, I mean, the good thing about it is that we got how many more races left in the season. So he's got plenty of time to make up for it. And he's got to get, what you said, top 35 in points. So pretty much lock yourself into the show every time we come to a track. So that's what he'll be aiming for, and whenever he gets, you know, the chances to make a show, he's got to capitalize on that opportunity.
Well, Trey, as we look out the window here at the booth, it's a beautiful day for racing. Clear, sunny skies once again. 72 degrees is the air temperature. 2-mile-an-hour winds going in eastward directions. That shouldn't play an impact on how these cars handle in the corners, as it's a crosswind across the racetrack from the front stretch to the back stretch, and there is only a 10% chance of rain here today in College Station, Texas. Obviously, as mentioned, this track located there. 2 miles in length is the Texas World Super Speedway. 22 degrees of banking in the corners, 12 degrees on the front stretch, 5 degrees on the back stretch. It is a very high-banked racetrack. Track opened in 1969. We've been racing here ever since the first season. We've raced here every season since then, 1981. And the past 5 winners, Trey Bardo did it in 1996, Trey Rennie in 1997, Nat Wagner in 1998, Marcus Satchi in 1999, and Keegan Thompson did it last season for Hendrick Motorsports. 40-lap race with 22 to 26 laps is the field window. So we'll see who tries and stretch it out a little bit longer. Pit entrance, very difficult here, as you have to enter at the entrance of turn 3 and not coming off turn 4 with how fast the speeds are. So we'll see who tries to tries to be a little bit more confident entering pit run, tries to enter a little bit later and get some spots up. He wants to stay out longer and try to make spots up that way to avoid the congestion entering pit road. We'll all see how it happens over 40 laps here at Texas World. Let's go down the track so the fire of the car is up for the Mountain Dew 400. And there roll off the 42 machines to do battle at the Texas World Speedway. 2 miles in length, but it races like a 2.5 mile super speedway. Let's start with the man, Trey, back in 40th place. Eli Bright has had a great season up to this point, but here at Texas World, he has struggled. Not good in practice, and was the slowest of the 45 cars in qualifying. He was 4 tenths off Brandon Beal, who went home, Trey. And DEI as a whole, not so good in qualifying. Their highest driver, 22nd, Anthony Hernandez. How could they rebound after a bad qualifying run?
I mean, maybe get together and some teamwork. I mean, like you said, it's pretty fast track, so you never know. Teamwork could come into play here, but for this 8 car here, right here, he's gotta figure out something for this race. I mean, race pace, or you get speed underneath it, because he does not want to start back here. He's got a lot of work to do.
And also watch out for the early dangers that could happen from starting towards the back. But also, you spoke about how this is a fast racetrack, high horsepower. Well, these Robert Yates Racing Fords, they love high horsepower racetracks. And Luke Ridney made the move over to Robert Yates Racing, looking for a win. His first ever NASCAR Winston Cup Series win. It hasn't come yet. He starts in 12th here today, Trey. Do you think that this could be the day that he finally breaks through?
Definitely see it, but I'm not going to jinx it, Joe. I'm not going to say yes or no.
You're not going to be the one to call it out, so we'll see if he can try and get it done. That's all we'll say about Luke Rennie. But at the front, Benny Lynn, Jordan Stout, then Tim Gary, Ronald Kennington, and Ryan Wilson are the front five. A huge mix of drivers towards the front. We'll see how it plays out over 40 laps in the Mountain Dew 400. Lynn will step on the gas first. There he goes. Green flag in the air at the Texas World Speedway.
You know, I want to say this is our most organized start to a race I think we've had all season.
I think so. They've just been double file all the way back. A little bit 3 wide back there, but yeah, normally we're 3 wide inside the top 10 at this point, but they've done a great job keeping it just double file as Ryan Wilson leads the pack off turn number 4 for the Petty Enterprises team. He's trying to lead the first lap. It looks like he will over Zidell as he dives to the inside, but Wilson leads the first lap on the Mountain Dew 400. Now Justin Zidell wants the lead from him, along with Walker Davis in the 19 coming to look 3 wide to the bottom of the racetrack.
Remember this, and we just finished one lap, and we already been, what, through 4 leaders already? I mean, the 33 started, the 10 might have had a little bit of a glimpse there, the 45 doesn't, now the 24 is out front, so from what I'm seeing, it's going to be more of a cycle-type race here, so it keeps even the more play. You know, by the end of this thing, you want to put yourself in the right position to be up front.
We'll have to see how the Goodyear Eagles hold up throughout this race. Last season, we saw some extreme tire wear, which led to the pack getting split up over the longer runs and not being as, you know, pass-efficient throughout the race. We'll see if Goodyear brought a harder tire, if the tire wear will be less, or if it's going to be just as much as it was last season. 4 wide further back of the pack, Osgood and Roberto Crutch Jr., the teammates in the middle. There were almost 5 wide a row behind them. They're 4 wide of multiple rows here, Trey, at the midpoint.
Getting really close. Keegan Thompson. They held it? Wow, that was close.
Yeah, if you were Keegan and Osgood there, that was the last thing you wanted to see, because normally in that situation you face the inside wall and you're hitting it.
Yeah, that would have been a big one too, but luckily these guys settled it out. But I mean, that's still a big group. They're 4 wide again, I think. No, they settled it back down.
That was Lathan Strickland that backed down the top. It looks like he's actually gonna be put 4 wide top again by
Burnett,
Rainey, and Mills. This is crazy stuff. Davis had led, now Tim Gary back for the top spot. The mid-pack trying to sort it back to 3, and it looks like they do. Now Brett Sierra wants the lead in the 25s. They look 4 wide again. Up the banking goes Kukulon. In the middle pulls in Benny Lynn. Down low, we have some other drivers like the 2 of Fitzwater, the 4 of Yepes. They are getting crazy back here. DeLello moving off line 3 wide as Brett Sierra led the lap in the 25.
Well, they started the race calm, Joe, and then I guess they heard me, and they said, well, let's prove me wrong once again this season, and... Yeah, we got this now.
Yeah, this is... this is ridiculous stuff here, Trey. And I don't know how much longer they can last like this. So far, they've done it. They're back down to three wide, so we'll go back up towards the front. Davidson Zidell climbed the banking at the front. Brett Sierra, Keyshawn Richardson, Tim Gary, 1, 2, 3. They've broken away. The side-by-side battle for fourth, Nolan Lawrence. Foskar Morsworth has moved up nicely. He's getting a nice run in the outside. We'll clear for fourth place in that 26. Great power off turn four for that Ford.
Well, he got a big run there. He's almost made his way back up to this top three here. He might actually do it if he can get another good run off this, as Conrad Evans had a big slide coming out of 1 and 2.
Yeah, he climbed the banking right there. Luckily, there's a lot of racetrack to use up. I think that 19 at Davis, he may have actually scraped the wall there with how slow he's going down the straightaway.
I thought I saw him tap it there, but I mean, it didn't look like a major tap, so I don't think it's going to cause too much damage. I don't know even know if I see any markings on the side of that car, but we'll definitely have to keep an eye on him to see if he's anything affected by that.
He's up top now. His teammate Jordan Edwards looks to get inside of him. Here comes Jamie Stammer Jr. being aggressive in the 71 down to the bottom of the racetrack. He has Rileysburg to back behind him. As back up to the front we go. Zachary DeLello trying to get a run, shuffled out by Keegan Thompson, is now going to shuffle Nolan Lawrence out, and Tim Gary 1 second from Keyshawn Richardson, but Richardson going to get a nice toe from Brett Sierra down the back straight.
Joe, we talked about Keegan Thompson last race, but it was at, like, the end, like, last lap the end. I mean, he had a big, big push here at the end of the last race, like I just said, but we'll have to see if, he's starting up front this time around, and he's near the front at the beginning of this one, so maybe he'll stay up here?
And as mentioned, he knows how to get it done. Trey did it last season here at Texas World, so he's looking to do it again. This pack getting very aggressive. This is inside the top 10, Trey. Ooh. They're going to be four wide. Jericho, the points, they're going to the middle. Jordan Stout, one of his nearest competitors in points, also there. Yepes in the four, who's one of the underfunded cars, backs out and says, I don't want to be in a crash. I want to keep my car clean. I want to make it to the end of all 40 laps.
Yeah, that's some. Jericho's being pretty aggressive for being the points leader. Apparently, he's not too afraid of losing it.
Apparently not. I mean, when you're on this long of a top 10 streak, Trey, you almost feel invincible, right? You almost think, like, nothing could go wrong to me. If I just be even more aggressive, I could maybe get the win finally.
Yeah, but at the same time, if you're a little more aggressive, you, one, make enemies, and two, have a better chance of wrecking up your car and ending your top 10 streak. So it's a delicate balance here for this 18 team. But so far, he's been doing a good job, but he's getting passed by Conrad at the moment, and I think it's going to shuffle him outside the top 10.
Did you see Jordan Stout up ahead of that? How he kind of went top to bottom. Looks like he was getting loose off the corner. But I think it was just him making a big move. In front, there's a block. Lawrence protecting the bottom. Blocks Ryan Wilson all the way to that white line on the bottom of the racetrack. Meanwhile, Keegan Thompson will make it a Hendrick 1-2 as he's going to get by Keyshawn Richardson. And as his sights set on teammate and Daytona 500 champion Brett Sierra up the road. And Tim Gary for MB2 Motorsports. He wants to get back where he started inside the top three. But look at Keegan. That car rotating so well on the bottom of the racetrack and gains on Brett Sierra off turn two.
Yeah, how big of a run he gets if he can make a move going into three. But this is two races in a row where Brett Sierra looks like he's had one of the most dominant cars, but Keegan Thompson's not going to have too much of that because he's going for the lead.
Keegan Thompson wants it in that number five. He got a little tight down low, though. Brett might get the run on the top. See how the pack now getting a little bit more strung out as we get into the race with more tire wear. But Keegan got a nice run off turn four. He's able to stay beside his teammate Brett Sierra. And all depends on where the help comes from. Keyshawn Richardson got a slingshot run with his teammate DeLello behind him. Took it to the inside. He'll try and grab second from Sierra. But looks like he might get third from Tim Gary and keep Sierra in second for now.
About Keyshawn Richardson's teammate there. He's got two of them behind him right now, Joe.
Yeah, Jordan Stout making his way up to the front, that number six. These three have already won this season for Roush Racing. Their teammate, Matthew Burnett, still looking for that victory. We'll see if he can try and work his way up to make it a Roush 1-2-3-4 towards the front. They can all get up there, but it's a Hendrick 1-2, and they're side-by-side, and Tim Gary wondering where to go. He has a run. He might take it three wide, but Keyshawn Richardson goes to the bottom with help from Zachary DeLello.
I thought Gary was going to make that move to the bottom there, but he, in all my opinion, he made the smarter move out of that. Can't be risking it this early in the race. And, I mean, so what have we seen out of the 10 car? He's had a strong car, so he can't be that worried about, you know, dropping too far back here. And as he's already caught the bottom lane again. He beat Richardson off two.
Yeah, he pulled Richardson off turn two, as mentioned, and he'll move up to second. So it's Brett Sierra, Tim Gary, 1-2. They've had a run-in earlier this season. Is that in the past, Trey? I don't know, but race car drivers, I know, you know, you have a long memory. So do you think that Tim and Brett are still a little bit agitated at each other?
I'm not going to put words in anyone's mouth, but I just want to see what happens when they get side by side here.
Yeah, I want to see Tim get up there and start battling Fred a little bit more and say, look it, you may have the better car, but I have the faster car at the moment. As here we go for third, Keyshawn Richardson and teammate Jordan Stout are going at it for Roush Racing. Keyshawn's going to give Stout the inside. Looks like maybe a spotter at the last second called inside because he was going down the racetrack before that.
Or he might have thought better about blocking a teammate there. I don't know. But yeah, it definitely looks like he double thought it there. And then he should be able to get in the hole here if he drops down. But I think Keegan Thompson's going to close in too quickly.
And Tim Gary, meanwhile, is just content right now to stay behind Brett Sierra because the more they battle for third, if the front two stay single file, they can actually pull away, get a gap. And then when pit stops start, they'll be in a good position right here. So maybe that's a good strategy of Tim Gary. Just stay behind this number 25, push him out. And then, you know, when pit stops happen, we can sort out from there.
Yeah, I mean, and another thing, you know, Brett Sierra, I mean, he battled for the lead last race, and we know he's got the better team car overall. So, I mean, for Tim Gary being a little bit lower, I mean, if he just follows in the 25's draft right here, you know, it's not the worst option to do that.
I do want to point out behind these front five, which are right now just, you know, some of the bigger names like Hendrick Motorsports and Roush Racing. A Stout looks for second on Tim Garrett. Looks like Tim might get the draft and the run off the top side to keep that second spot just outside the top five for Ultra Motorsports. Jose Mills, that single car team, doing a really good job here. It's Keyshawn Richardson actually protecting the bottom in the 9-9. Mills going to go down there with them. But behind even the 7, you have some more smaller teams like Nolan Lawrence, Foscar Motorsports, the 4 of Diego Yepes for Morgan McClure Motorsports. How about Lathan Strickland for DI? How bad they qualified when now one of their cars is inside the top 10 currently. And the number 66, another Haas car, Motorsports car, Mitch Corbett, Sumit Ozgen for Petty Enterprises. How about Ronald Kennington still hanging in tough in that number 77 Jasper Motorsports team? So a lot of these smaller teams, Trey, they've made the run inside the top 15, and they're staying there.
She just love races like this, Joe.
I do. I mean, I love to see the parity. It's great for these smaller teams to have a shot at the front end. You know, if they win it, that's an amazing feat.
Exactly. And I mean, you know, we're going to come to more races like this throughout the season. So if anything, these are showing these top, you know, top teams like HMS, you know, Roush, RCR, that some of these lower guys got some pretty tough power on them. So you might want to work with them. It might suit you out later in the run here. But as you said, Lathan Strickland, who was all the way in the back, he's working his way up. As Keegan Thompson's making a three wide for second.
Look at Lathan behind them as they're three wide for second. Lathan just shoved Keyshawn up the track. And look how slow the 99 is. I mean, that really hurt Keyshawn Richardson, but Strickland is coming through. That 15, it looks like he may have saved his tires, maybe, because now that we're in the long run, about 5 laps away from pitting, he's one that's able to make moves while many others are kind of stuck where they are.
See how Richardson feels about that one after the race, huh? I don't know if he'd be the happiest about that.
No, not when it happens at 200 miles an hour, right? I don't think it's appreciated in that regard.
No, not at all. I know I would not be very happy. I've had it happen a couple of times, but you know, we won't get into that right now. I probably said some very mean words, but again, you know, it's in the past. We forget about it.
Speaking of the past, you know, back to the parody segment, as Lathan Strickland just worked his way up inside the top five just like that. I don't think I've been following, you know, the Winston Cup Series my whole life, Trey. I don't think I've ever seen the parody where it is right now in this 2001 season. We have seen so many teams come closer to the top guys, so many teams that are at the front of the field. I mean, I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like this ever in the Winston Cup Series.
Yeah, I know. I mean, when I was in the car, you know, and I've ever seen, like, a guy I normally don't see up front, I mean, it's always cool to see. I mean, I don't like it when they're ahead of me, but that's a different story. But, I mean, this is amazing. I'm loving this. You know, these guys get the TV time they need. It might bring more sponsors to their team. You never know what, you know, the benefits could be of it, especially with them running good.
I mean, it's great to see, you know, Lathan Strickland running well because this is the first race for his new sponsor, Menards. So, as you mentioned, bringing new sponsors to the team. And right now, Lathan putting in a good run for the Menards car. Is here we go. Keegan Thompson, Tim Gary, side by side for a second. The best run Keegan's had for that second place this whole time. Jordan Stout, that is a big pole punch in the air for him. Does he take it? Looks like Lathan might take it because he has an even bigger hole punch in the air. Three wide to the bottom for the 15 for third place.
I'm going to go with you, Joe. I think he's saving up his stuff. I mean, he's just on rails right now. He's just making moves that, oh, that was close.
And you know what? Now it's not time to save. Now he's pushing because we are within 2 to 5 laps of pit stops this time by. Halfway through the Mountain Dew 400 at Texas World. No caution flag so far in this race. Brett Sierra has definitely led the most laps. It's a gaggle of cars second on back. The big thing's going to be how pit stops go. Lathan looking 3 wide for a second. Tim Gary's running. He's going to try and push Keegan Thompson to get himself clear. But they're still 3 wide. They're going to stay like that into turn one. Can Lathan make it stick on the bottom? What does Stout do? And what does Thompson do all the way up top?
I don't know what they're going to do, but I know who's loving this right now. It's Brett Sear in that 25. I mean, he's led how many laps so far? And the more these guys battles, the more he can slowly pull away, which I think there was almost contact there between Tim Gary and Keegan Thompson.
There was. It was very close for the 10 and the 5, but they were able to sort it out. But the big question, how do the pit strategies play out in this one? When do you pit, and how long do you want to stay out if you do stay out a little bit longer? We saw last season how congested pit entry is because it happens at the entrance of turn 3. It doesn't happen off turn 4 with how fast the speeds are. That would be way too dangerous trying to make it into pit road. So it happens into turn 3, but this man might not want to pit because his car's amazing! Lathan Stricken for the lead, Trey! He started back around 29th or 30th!
I don't know what got into this man this week. It might be something with his drink. They might have put an energy drink in it? I don't know, but he is absolutely insane right now.
Do you think he's jacked up on some Mountain Dew?
He might be jacked up on some Mountain Dew.
he wants to win the race for Mountain Dew. Maybe he had some Mountain Dew. Meanwhile, another driver is really coming through the field. Cement Oskin in this number 44. He's up to fourth, Trey. I mean, this is a Penny Enterprises car. He's up in fourth place with it. This is outstanding. Lathan again going to peek into turn one as we're in the pit window. Brett goes up the racetrack. Lathan has the inside. And where does Tim Gary in third go? So he'll get beside Brett Sear and side draft him. And it clears Lathan out front.
And if he's going to go up top here, is that going to help Tim at all? Tim's actually going to get put in the middle three wide with the 44 of Oskin on the bottom.
How about Penny?
Oh, are they coming in?
It looks like the 44 might be. No, he's
That's
not.
A lot of cars go to the bottom, so I thought they were all coming at the same time.
Oh my gosh, look at the blocking! Stone trying to block Thompson all the way to the apron goes Keegan. This is crazy stuff at the front. Look at all these cars that are still right together.
There was someone.
Yeah, that was a very early pitter. In fact, he's actually the only one so far to have pitted. Who was that? It was the 71 of Jamie Stammer Jr., so he could possibly gain some time being the only car in pit road and with the fresher tires the soonest.
Yeah, so we'll have to see if that benefits him at all. But I mean, this right here is crazy. Look how bunched up these guys are.
And so far, I don't see anyone making a move. So Stanworth was a very early move, but at the moment, everyone might be getting a little bit better fuel mileage than thought. As here comes Tim Gary. He wants to lead this race for MB2 Motorsports. Look at the top three. Would you have expected this to be the top three, Trey, over halfway into the race?
No, but I'm loving it. I mean, they're going to make it three wide for the lead here. If he can get a good run, he's not going to get it. But still, I mean, it's almost as if Brett lost the lead. Everyone just goes, it's my turn.
Yeah, now Tim Gary's going to take it. He's been second, third this whole race. Well, here he is now leading Lathan Strickland.
Oh, never mind. Nope.
Yep, Lathan wants it back. Look at the blocking. Oh, the six is going to come in.
Okay, if there was anyone closer behind him, that might not have been the best move to do it right there, but it worked.
Yeah, Jordan Stout going to be the first of the front runners to come in, and so far the only, really, of the front runners to come in.
I'm surprised they're staying out this long.
I am too, but, you know.
Unless we got our estimates off.
You know what? Maybe the fuel mileage over the offseason could have gotten better, Trey. You know, these engineers, you never know what they do with their cars.
Yeah. Don't look at me to tell you when they're going to come in. I was just, my crew chief have said, hey, make sure you come in this lap big. All right, I'll do my best. So don't look at me for that information.
Brett Sear might be pitting this time as he's diving down to the bottom. Here he comes with Miley Spurley Tube, and this will bring a bigger wave in. Not as big, though. I mean, we're still, look at Keyshawn. Is he going to be pitting really late here? Oh, he did.
Maybe he got caught up top there, but I mean, look at everyone he jumped.
Yeah, he jumped all those guys, but you got to know that these drivers that are, caution's out.
Oh, no. What happened?
Maybe.
What?
Evan Hunter? So far. Oh, the 93 Jack Haas.
Oh, jeez. Oh, no. He's got. Is that roof damage?
Yeah, he's got all sorts of damage. So, obviously, he's been in the wall with someone. So, now, who took the caution and who has everyone taken it? It looks like yes. So, now, can these guys hurry off pit road to try and maybe jump these guys? They definitely don't want to fall lap down.
No, I think they're going to be fine, though. But so would that's going to benefit the guys on... Oh, what the...
Is Jordan Stout okay?
Is he all right? He's in the grass still?
Yeah, he's got to be careful. He has to get going now, or else he's going to hit some drivers.
Oh, he's made it.
Yeah,
is he going to go down pit? He's coming back. Okay, that was... All right, cool. Maybe we'll have to talk with... Well, maybe we'll hear something from NASCAR about that decision. I don't know what just happened.
Yeah, I'm sure the officials are not the happiest.
No, I mean, maybe the grass need to cut. I don't know.
the long carrier is wondering what in the world Jordan Stout was thinking there.
He might get a new sponsor here with a tractor company or something.
You know, John Deere did sponsor Roush Racing last year.
They did
leave, but I hope they come back because it's two tires. Look at the 44's pit stop.
Hey, wow. That was a big jump.
Yeah, so it might be Sumit Ozgun with the lead of this race. We'll have to see. Tim Gary's going to leave and try and beat, but where are the drivers that pitted? Now are these guys on the lead lap? If they're on the lead lap, that's amazing. It's Jamie Stimmer Jr. in the lead lap.
Oh, well, talk about getting that really good jump.
Nope. Did he? Four laps down.
4 laps down. What happened with him?
Yeah, we'll have to see when we're checking on the ninth reel. See if anyone can find what happened to that 71 and see if there was some sort of incident that maybe made him come down for a repair damage. But at the moment, looks like the leader is going to be Riley Spurley, who went to 28. Noah Clifton, who failed an inspection, should be second, along with Caden Lynn, who also failed an inspection. So we'll get the scoring sorted out, and we'll come back and show you what happened around the caution flag, as it looks like it may have been Jack Haas and someone else possibly involved in this crash at Texas World. Well, Trey, this didn't bring out the yellow, but certainly a scary moment for everyone on pit road.
I mean, that was a hard hit, and then he just, look how much speed he has going right now.
Yeah, I'd guarantee that's over 100 miles an hour still.
I mean, good job for him keeping it in the grass and not actually going on the pavement at all, and then he just gets it going like nothing ever happened.
Yeah, it's a very scary moment. Oh my
goodness. Did he not have steering?
He hit pretty hard. You have to wonder if maybe it knocked something off in the steer. Toe knocked out, possibly.
It might have fixed it with hitting the other side right there. I don't know, but that was a hard hit.
So that didn't bring out the yellow tray. Let's go see now what happened to Jack Haas to bring out the first yellow flag here in the Mountain Dew 400. Trey, a very scary ride for Jack Haas here at the Texas World Speedway. Entering turns 3 and 4, looks like he's going to make a late move to try and pit, but Atkins to his inside is the very, very, very big danger in that. And right here, he climbs the concrete wall.
Oh my goodness. He came so close to going over top of that wall, Joe.
Yeah, why is there no catch fence in that corner, Trey?
I don't know. Where does he even start is the real question, but he comes back on the wheels, and we saw him drive into pit road, I think. Did he drive into pit road? I don't remember.
Gotten towed there. Yeah. So
yeah, he got towed there.
Jack Haas, a scary incident here. Tech World, let's take a look at it once again in full speed. Another look at this Jack Haas wreck once again at full speed. And
it's just miscommunication, you got to think, between driver and spotter.
And a scary moment for Jack Haas. Luckily, he kept it in the ballpark. And no one else hit him, and it came back onto all fours. Unfortunately, it will be the end of Jack Haas's race, and it's going to shake up the pit strategy. Some drivers were on pit road, and it looks like it might be Keyshawn Richardson to cycle out as the race leader in the number 99 for Roush Racing here at Texas World. Trey coming back to the green flag with 10 to go, and this is going to be a chaotic restart. Drivers at the front that have been at the front all race long. We have a damaged car at the tail end of the lead lap, and it's going to be Keyshawn Richardson with the lead over Riley Sproutube and Noah Clifton in third. And we haven't had a chance, Trey, to do our lunch chat for the week, but let's do it. Last week we asked, which major city should a NASCAR track be built next to? Well, Trey, once again you were right, but these four options, very, very spread out. New York City, 46%. Boston with 37%, Detroit with 14%, and Philadelphia 2%, Trey.
Ah, 3 for 3, Joe. What can I say?
3 for 3, but now let's see if you can get this one. I think this could be another mixed bag, as we've come to so many different track types this season. Which is your favorite track type? Short tracks, the ones under a mile in length. How about the short ovals from a mile to about a mile and a third? Think about, Rockingham to Darlington type. How about the intermediates, 1.5 mile? Or how about the speedways, 2 miles or up?
I pick two or just one?
Just one.
Speedways. I mean, everyone gets a chance to win at a speedway. You got the big one. You got teammates working. It's going to be speedway. You cannot choose speedway.
How about...
You cannot not choose speedway is what I meant to say.
How about if you were a driver?
None. Okay. Unless I'm winning.
Okay.
Unless I'm winning. So.
Well, Keyshawn Richardson is going to be liking the speedways right now because he's winning as he takes the green flag, gets on the gas really well for Sproutube. But now he's trying to get around Jamie Stammer Jr. 71 pulls to the inside because he can't pass to the inside for the line, but he might hold up some other drivers down the bottom.
Look, the 0-1's up front.
Yeah, Caden Lynn, fastest in practice, failed inspection, started last, and it looks like Noah Clifton's going to be the one left down behind the 71.
This is going to get sketchy coming off a 2. Where is it going to go? Oh, everyone's stuck outside.
Everyone is stuck outside. Meanwhile, Brett Sear wants to lead back. Mathis Wells going for 2 in a row up to second. Where is the 20 come from? How about Jacob Boyd for the Wood Brothers to third, and Tim Gary coming back in the 10? again.
Ooh, that 21 had a big stall moment right there coming out of four there, and it held up Tim Gary a little bit, but Joe, it's two races in a row with these two.
Yep, Matthew as well as Brett Stewart going at it again behind some contact. Hoskin and Lynn are rubbing. Oh my gosh, into turn one. That was close.
Now the real question is what's going to happen coming off of four? The 01's going to back out, so good thing for him because I don't think he wanted to be stuck up top four wide.
And meanwhile, at the front, with the fresh tires, obviously, you know, all these drivers have new tires. They have the grip, so they're starting to race very hard. You want to get the track position before the tires start to wear out. Mathis Wells moves to the front in the number 20 for Joe Gibbs Racing. Tim Gary up to second. He wants a shot at the race victory. And here comes Keyshawn Richardson back. Jacob Boyd still inside the top five. Mitch Corbett for House Car Motorsports up here in Lathan Strickland. And a whole gaggle of cars behind them, all looking to get up to the front at the end. Richardson 3-1 on Gary and Wells.
That was a power move. Do you think these drivers are a little tired of seeing Roush up front?
I think they are. Eight to go, so, I mean, we have a lot of time left at Texas. Oh, there they go in the back! Ryan Wilson, others go around. This will be out the yellow, and it will be a late race restart. Who wants the lead? Is it going to be Keyshawn Richardson? Looks like it will be. He's going to clear Tim Gary. Back around to the yellow flag. Keyshawn, Gary, Wells will be third. Sierra fourth, Mitch Corbett will be inside the top five for Haas Car Motorsports, and the gaggle of cars back to about 10th will have to sort it out under the pace laps. Trey, this race has taken a chaotic turn. It'll be Richardson with the lead again, Fitzwater and Luke Rainey involved. Diego Yepes was having such a good day. Ryan Wilson qualified well, and his teammate Richard Crown Jr. also involved, and the 17.
Big wreck.
Yeah, Matthew Burnett has not won this season. The only one for Roush Racing. He's in it again. And do you think possibly it had to do with the 71 being slower?
I mean, you would have to think. I mean, I feel like by that point, everyone would have gotten around him by then. He was so slow, but I mean, it might be.
Yeah, we'll have to see, obviously. We'll have to check out the replays, see what happened, see how badly Noah Clifton was hurt by that. He's all the way down the back half of the field, as this field is very, very. It's a weird lineup. Let's just say that. I don't think I've ever seen a lineup. Yeah, I've never seen a lineup quite like this. Let's go take a look at what brought out the second caution flag of the day here in the Mountain Dew 400 at Texas World. Well, Trey, coming off turn number two, Laura Chung behind the two Petty Enterprises cars of Ryan Wilson and Roberto Crown Jr. And it looks like Laura Chung aero tight or a misjudgment here, possibly?
I don't know, but I mean, it's not that hard to tell who's at fault for that one. I mean, just completely hooked the 43, turned it into the 45. Oh. Luke Rainey had nowhere to go. Fitzwater, literally nowhere to go. Huge hit, though. The four innocent bystanders as well. And then 17 also had just no place to go whatsoever. But yeah, I mean, like you said, I would have to think she got tight. But at the same time, you got to control the race car a little bit.
Yeah, unfortunate for the drivers involved. It was a lot of big names. These are a lot of big teams like Fitzwater, Luke Rainey, Burnett, even Yepes, and the two Petty Enterprises cars. All cars really had their moments at the front here today, but unfortunately they're going to end towards the back, maybe even out and in the garage. We'll go take a look at this wreck once again. Well, Trey, here's our stationary camera looking down the back straight, and you can see the wreck from afar as it starts to come down towards the entrance of turn three.
The 43 just disappears off the screen. But, yeah, I mean, it's just, I guess, a product of being in the back with that jumbo of cars right there is that one mistake can cost many, many drivers their race.
Yeah, unfortunate. These two, you know, Luke Rainey over from that two ride from last season. It looks like this season hasn't been much better at the moment. At the front of the field, Keyshawn Richardson looking for a second win of the season to become the first driver to win multiple races. But hungry drivers like Tim Gary, Mitch Corbett, Jacob Boyd, Lathan Strickland are all inside the top 10. We'll restart with under 5 to go in the Mountain Dew 400 at the Texas World Speedway. 3 laps to go in the Mountain Dew 400 at the Texas World Speedway. So we know, Trey, this will be the final restart. Even if we get another yellow flag, there will not be enough time to clean up the wreck. And we'll look at the cars out. Matthew Burnett, Luke Rennie both out. Fitzwater's fallen a lap down. Stanford Jr. still 4 laps down. Leaves us 37 cars on the lead lap. Drivers at the back like the 4, 45, 43. Might be hoping for some more carnage on this restart to gain some positions. And with the drivers at the front, there could be some carnage. Keyshawn Richardson for Roush Racing looking to go for their fourth win on the season and his second win as a driver. Tim Gary for NB2 Motorsports trying to get it done for that team in second. Mathiswell is looking for back-to-back in third. Brett Sarah won at the Daytona 500, looking for another win in fourth. And Mitch Corbett looking for his first ever in the first ever House Car Motorsports in fifth. Jacob Boyd trying to bring the Wood Brothers back to fame and glory in sixth. Lathan Strickland looking for a win for the new DEI team in seventh. Riley Spurgeon with the powerhouse. Robert Yates racing up to eighth. How about Ronald Kennington for Jeff Motorsports in ninth? And the new startup team, Jordan Edwards, has that inside the top 10. Pace car in, three to go. Trey, who can get it done at Texas World?
Good jump for the front two.
Yeah, Tim might try and look here, possibly.
They got the space for it.
There he goes.
He had enough of a... Oh, never mind, he is.
Tim Gary for the lead for NB2 Motorsports. Can he clear? And if he can't, how big of a run does Mathis Wells have entering turn three?
He's not going to clear quite yet. Oh, the 66 is going to look. Oh, he got there.
Yeah, you know, these smaller teams, they want to get it done. But look at that, stalls them all out. Tim Garrison loves seeing side-by-side behind him. Wells and Richardson side-by-side for a second. Back around 4 miles and two laps to go. They're still side-by-side for a second. Lathan Strickland going for a top five. He wants to be up here in case the front two start battling. He might have a shot in the 15.
I mean, we saw how fast he was earlier this race. He's going to have enough for this time around. Look at the power on the bottom for that 15. He's going to have a run, though, on the bottom coming off at two. He's losing spots.
Mitch Corbett might be yeah, he is clear in third, so now he has a shot. He's gonna go for second
there
here.
He goes.
House Car Motorsports wants a win. Can Mitch Corbett get to Tim Gary? He's clear on Mathis Wells. Gary leads for NB2 Motorsports. House Car Motorsports is in second. It's gonna come down to the final 2 miles. White flag one more time around Texas World.
Can he make up that one to two car lengths right there to Tim Gary? We'll have to see what he can do. He's got no problems behind him here. He might get a good run coming off of two this time.
We'll have to see, though.
Have
to see what the draft can do down this back straightaway. Tim Gary, though, that car has been stout all day long, and it looks like he might have enough. But into turns three and four for the final time, does Corbett have any final run at this number 10?
I thought it.
I think Tim Gary for NB2 Motorsports. Off four, Tim Gary, new to the series, and his first win in his sixth race as a full-time driver. Tim Gary wins at Texas World for NB2 Motorsports. There's his team owner, Evan Hunter, who has to be absolutely, he has to be celebrating in that car right now, even though he didn't get a good result.
I mean, you have to think so. It's one thing to be a team owner and get your first win, but to be another driver in the same race and watch your teammate and, you know, guy you hired to race your car get a win, that's got to be an unreal feeling.
And Tim Gary has been the most pleasant surprise of the season. This new startup number 10 team, you know, they got materials from Tyler Jett Motorsports, who performed not all too great last season. And you had to wonder, how great was the startup team going to be for NB2 Motorsports? Were they going to struggle with starting up another team? Well, Tim Gary has shown that they're not. He's going to be inside the top 10 in points, Trey, after this victory. And that makes it six different winners in the first six races.
I mean, it's going to make you think, you know. He was hired by Hendrick last season to fill in for Brett Sear when he was out with his injury. Maybe they saw something in him that not a lot of people saw. And as you said, he got hired by this lower team, and he's clearly proven that he's definitely got talent underneath that, you know, underneath that driver's suit there. So I'm excited to see what else he can do the rest of the season.
Do you think Hendrick's going to be kicking themselves for not maybe opening up a fourth car to give Tim a spot with his team?
Hey, you never know what the future holds, Joe.
That's true. As we take a look at the finishing results, Tim Gary the winner. And how about, Trey, this top three, the outstanding Tim Gary for NB2 Motorsports, Mitch Corbett for Haas Carter Motorsports, and Lathan Strickland for DEI, the top three finishers.
I love that. I mean, Lathan was on rails today. Absolute rails today. He was flying, and then the 66, we didn't talk about him too much, but hey, we never take away from a surprise finish from that team, and that's really going to give them, you know, a lot of confidence boost, and hopefully we'll see it in the next race we go to here.
fourth place, fifth place, kind of, you know, normal there. Keyshawn Richardson and Mathis Wells both having really good points days. How about Ronald Kennington started inside the top five, gets sixth place for Jasper Motorsports in the number 77. Jordan Edwards for Evernham Motorsports gets them a top seven. Riley Spurtube, eighth. Jacob Boyd, his best run of the season so far, ninth place for the Wood Brothers. And Brett Sierra ends out in the top 10 for Hendrick Motorsports. In fact, that was the highest finishing Hendrick Carter today. And you look at, you know, Trey, this top 10, look at the teams. MB2, Haas Car Motorsports, Dale Earnhardt Incorporated, Roush Racing, Joe Gibbs, Jasper Motorsports, Evernham, Robert Yates, Wood Brothers, Hendrick. 10 teams in the top 10.
That's, when was the last time that happened?
Well, how about 11 teams inside the top 11? Because Logan Williams got 11th for Brett Bodine Racing.
That makes it even more, like, when was the last time that happened, Joe? I don't even remember.
I don't know the stats on that, Trey, and I have to imagine it may have never happened. With how competitive this season has been, it may have never happened.
We made history.
We saw history today, and unfortunately, for Chris Jericho's top 10 streak ends, but if there was ever a race where it was going to end, it would be the one where 10 different teams got inside the top 10. Jericho's still 12th, though, so really good day and should keep the points lead. Caden Lynn from 42nd on the grid to 13th, and Zydell and Thompson both with top 15s. Evan Hunter's teammate won. He gets 16th. Not a bad day for MB2 Motorsports at all. Walker Davis, Sebastian Kukulon, Roger Ray, and then Anthony Hernandez round out the top 20. We look down to Medowski in 21st. Eli Bright from his really bad starting spot and practice results, 22nd. Can't really complain about that. Conrad Evans has just not had the footing at all this season, 23rd. Roush kind of struggled here today with DeLello getting 24th. Jordan Stout, 25th. Atkins didn't have the card underneath him here today in 26th. Mitchell Collins, 27th. Nolan Lawrence, 28th. You look down the 40 to the 92, complete the top 30. Jose Mills was at the front for a little bit today, along with Noah Clifton, but Clifton got stuck behind Jamie Stammer Jr. And you look down at the cars damage, like the 43, 45, and 4, and then the 2 a lap down, 71, 4 laps down, after the cars out, 88, 17, and 93. So, Trey, I know you probably don't want to leave the Texas World Super Speedway, because these points after today look just crazy with, you know, 11 teams finishing inside the top 11. But I think we're going to be going to, you know, another track type that could promote some different drivers at the front as we head to the Riverside International Raceway out in California, Road Course Racing for the Budweiser 400. Trey, what do you think we're going to see out of that one?
Hopefully it's as fun as this one was.
I hope so.
Are you sure we just can't have the entire season here?
Well, you know what, Trey? This may make a good bargain for having a second race next season, right?
I'll put in a personal word to whoever makes the schedule, and we'll see what we can get done.
We will see. So Texas World was a great one. Tim Gary for MB2 Motorsports claims victory. Congratulations to that team. And for Trey Bardo, I'm Joe Rakowski. See you guys for race number 7, the Budweiser 400 at the Riverside Raceway.